This is Screen Junkies Movie Fights, brought to you by Loot Crate. Now your host, Andy Signor.
Greetings, Screen Junkies, and welcome to a championship edition of Movie Fights. We've had several weeks leading up to this. I am so excited to watch who's going to take home this belt today. We have some awesome, epic fights for our champions today, including what's the ultimate Game of Thrones spinoff movie? Yes, we figured out a way to get some TV in here. Also, what should Josh Whedon direct next?
Or Joss.
Sorry, I meant it, and then I realized I was saying it wrong. As well as the best movie of the 2000s and so much more fun stuff, so stay tuned. This is going to be an amazingly epic episode because these three champions today have all been up there, and this is going to be the battle of all battles, I think, for movie fights, so get excited. As always, if you don't like a battle we're talking about, click on the bottom right on YouTube. You can skip ahead and pick your fight to zoom ahead to any of the debates that we're discussing today, so check that out. And always, please remember we're on iTunes, so go subscribe, rate, and comment to us there. We have a new RSS feed. There's an old one and a new one. Please go subscribe to the new one. The link is in the description below on YouTube. We would love your support to keep us going strong on iTunes. So this is a very special week of Movie Fights. As I said, it's the championship round. The belt is hopefully on the line. When Dan comes in here, we'll make that official. But our gladiators have fought through six rounds of Movie Fights to earn their spot here. So congrats, fellas. This is epic. Are you guys nervous?
Nope, we got buys. We had an easier time getting here than everyone.
Yeah, it wasn't that hard.
Yeah.
Oh, jeez. Okay. All right, well, let's meet our fighters. Let's play our intro clip and meet who's fighting.
Today's fighters are Nick Mundy, Screen Junkies resident fixer, 4 wins, 3 losses. Spencer Gilbert, writer of Honest Trailers, 4 wins, 3 losses. Dan Merle, undefeated Movie Fights champion, 6 wins.
Wow.
Woo! Dan's got nothing else.
Amazing. Undefeated. That's mean. He's got a lot. He's a very nice person.
I know, but...
Wow. So
gloves are off.
This is amazing. So we have here 4 wins, 3 losses, Spencer Gilbert.
What's up?
Welcome.
Yeah, I know these guys planned a lot, but as Mike Tyson said, everyone's got a plan until they get punched in the mouth. I'm ready to go.
Next to him, also 4 wins, 3 losses, it's Nick Mundy.
Yep, and I just got Dan's phone. He left it up here, and I've been going through it. And well, his secrets.
Don't do that. So, speaking of Dan, let's introduce the made man himself, Mr. Dan Merle.
This is where we fight! This is where they die!
I must break you.
You tell them I'm coming! And hell's coming with me, you hear? Hell's coming with me!
Oh my God! The champion's in the house wearing the belt and a Ray 2 shirt!
Huh.
Wow! Dan Merle, are you officially putting the belt on the line for today's battle?
I am.
As soon as he can take it off.
Hey, at least it has to be adjustable to fit a number of sizes.
Wow. Wow, hand it over, sir. Good sir, you have kept this.
Including yours, you can.
As I knock over every action figure, you have kept this in very good hands. I am honored to hold it and put it up for auction here.
Here we go.
To the best fighter. Now, you guys, he's officially made this the case. The belt is on the line. Oh my goodness, I am so excited.
There was a lot of hubris going on right there.
It's an entrance, it's showmanship.
Wow.
It's a nice entrance.
Yeah.
It's a very nice entrance.
Before we get to the fights, I need to do one more entrance, introduction entrance. You've demanded this man on the Fact Checker. We are so honored he's here. It's Movie Man, Scott Mance, co-host of Profiles, the Rain Man, Rain Mance, as we called it, the IMDb beast. He knows the dates from Adam. I'm so excited to have him here and fact-checking today's championship bout.
Thank you so much, Dan. I am not worthy. I'll do right by you. But really, I don't need this. It's all here, brother. That's all true.
Wow.
He could have my job after this.
Do you guys feel good about him being there fact-checking today?
Yeah, why are you gambling?
I love it. I'm not relying on facts today at all.
Why are we at the track? You can do this. Why are we making money?
This episode has been so excited that we had so many people contribute fan art just for this battle. I wanted to take a quick second just to show off some of these amazing images that we got brought in. And I want to thank all these artists. We had Dan Hamilton.
That's a good one.
That was a great one. My God, that was awesome. Thank you, guys. I don't know who did which, but I'm thanking a bunch of people here. Dan Hamilton, Doug Joseph.
This one is
Jerry
great
Ross,
Running Man.
Harry Vincent, Michael Whelan, thank you guys all so much for making these amazing, awesome fan arts. Please keep them coming. Tweet them to me and Screen Junkies and the crew here. We will love to continue to see your fan art week to week. We will show off the best ones. Thank you guys so much. All right, this
is
amazing.
I really like the one where Dan's smiling because I've never seen a picture of that. Like, that's some really good Photoshop art. I've never seen a picture of Dan smiling.
Look at Make sure you talk to the mic, Nick. Thank you very much. Okay, great. So as always, you know hopefully as the show works. This is a tough one. I'm friends with all you guys. I am not going in with any preconceived notions, so I don't know who's going to win, and I don't know who I want to win. It doesn't matter. I'm going off your arguments, your passion, your creativity. Everyone understands the rules of the show works. Yes?
Let's get it on. Let's
Before we start, I want to thank someone special, very special, and thank our sponsor, Loot Crate. Guys, we need sponsors to make this show, and we are so honored to have a sponsor we actually all use. It's Loot Crate. I don't know if you guys know about Loot Crate. They send out specifically curated items that fit the geek and gamer lifestyle directly to your door for less than $20 a month. Just a couple of months ago, in one of their boxes, they sent me this book for free. I don't know if you guys have read this yet, Ready Player One. I loved it. It's a great book. Steven Spielberg just adapted it. He's going to turn it into a movie. They say it on the front, and it's true. It's Willy Wonka meets The Matrix. I can't describe it any other way, but it's like this pop culture Goonies fascinating future ride, and I would highly recommend checking it out. But I wouldn't have known unless I was subscribing to Loot Crate because they sent it to me for free, and then I checked it out. So, guys, every week they give you amazing things. Please go check them out. And to do that, go to lootcrate.com/moviefights. Link is in the description below. And if you use the special code that we sent you, code MOVIEFIGHTS, you will get 10% off your new subscription. You'll be supporting this show. You'll be supporting our friends at Loot Crate. So please go support them and help us here continue to do movie fights. So thanks, Loot Crate. Guys, let's get this championship started, yes?
Yeah!
Woo! In the great words of Ron Burgundy and so many others.
Now let's do this!
This is where we fight!
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 Fight! Fight!
Round one. Championship battle. Round one. Game of Thrones premieres this Sunday. Now, a lot of people want us to do TV fights. We don't do that yet. Maybe someday. But we thought, you know, Game of Thrones is sort of transcending TV, and because they did it in IMAX, there's so many things about it. We wanted to ask, several people asked us this, Corey Barber and Justin Morris on Twitter, both, and several others asked us, pitch us the ultimate Game of Thrones spin-off movie. Now, I want to be clear. This is based off the show, not the books. I know we haven't all read the books.
So no reading here.
Even the playing field. We're basing our spin-off off the show. Which we hopefully have all caught up and know. So I don't think there are many spoilers. Let us know if there are. But that's the pitch here. That's the fight. Spencer, you're starting us off.
All right. So I'm going to go prequel here. And forgive me in advance for a little bit of exposition, but I'd like everyone to just close their eyes and imagine some boobs while I'm saying it. So no. We have the real Game of Thrones feel. So everyone, just close your eyes. Imagine you're in Littlefinger's whorehouse. Here we go. It's Westeros, 16 years before the start of the TV series. The Mad King, Aerys Targaryen, Khaleesi's granddad, and the Crown Prince abduct Ned Stark's sister, kill Ned Stark's brother, and burn Ned Stark's father alive. Because if your last name is Stark in the Game of Thrones universe, F you. So,
sadly, true.
Yeah, true. Ned will join forces with his best bud, Robert Baratheon, gather their allies, and lead their houses against the Crown and take the Iron Throne for themselves. This is Game of Thrones Rebellion.
So it's Ned Stark, Robert Baratheon, younger?
Younger, how they took the throne.
Wow, okay. That's fun. All right, Nick, what's your pitch?
Well, I'm doing an idea that, and granted we haven't heard Dan's, that you could just see in the show. That could just be a flashback, what Spencer did. I'm sure it's the same thing with Spencer. I'm using the movie format to actually push the boundaries of the Game of Thrones universe. That's why it will be an animated American Tale classic type movie that tells the tale of Sir Pounce, voiced by Peter Dinklage, who is Joffrey's brother's
cat
as Tom he tries to unite the seven animal kingdoms of Whiskeros and deal with the political machinations of Cat's Landing. Now, I know what some of you guys are thinking.
Are you throwing that?
No, I know what some of you guys are thinking. You think this is a kid's movie? Dead wrong. This is the most violent movie in the history of animation. Because with human beings and props and special effects, there's only so much violence you can do. With animation, you can just draw and create whatever's in your sick, demented George R. R. Martin mind. And that's why we can push the boundaries harder than everything we can ever do. We'll deal with direwolves, the white four-legged walkers, three-eyed ravens, and animal wogs controlling people. Also, we'll meet the real mother of dragons, a dragon. You think you were shocked by the incest of Game of Thrones? Wait until you see the interspecies intercourse of A Song of Mice and Fire. This is Gurr of Thrones.
Wow. The furry community is going nuts right now.
The community of life is going nuts.
All right, Mr. Previous Champion up on the line. Dan, what do you think?
That's legitimately hard to follow.
Oh, boy.
Point.
So, mine is Nick, you were right. It is also set before the events of Game of Thrones. Spencer, you're starting 16 years before Game of Thrones. I'm starting 8,000 years before the beginning of the show. And this is going to be Game of Thrones, The Night's Watch. And it's going to tell, in season one, it's not really referenced in the show that much, but in season one, Bran has told a story about thousands of years ago, there was an endless night and the longest winter, and the Westeros was invaded by people from the north, and those are what we now see in the show as White Walkers. Basically, but there was no wall, and they came down from the north and invaded Westeros, and they had to be fought back, and then the wall was built to protect the rest of the country, and the Night's Watch was founded. So that's what my story is going to be. It's going to be this epic battle for survival, pushing the White Walkers back north, the building of the wall, and then the establishment of the Crows, the Night's Watch, the Watchers on the Wall, to protect Westeros.
Wow, guys. Wow. Go ahead, let's fight this
out. How can we argue against Nick's pitch? I'm really at a loss here.
Yeah, it's that good.
But I'm just going to focus on Dan for now. I'm just going to focus on Dan.
A coward's move. But have your time.
I feel like what you picked, Dan, is focusing on the worst aspect of Game of Thrones, which is the fantasy element, which is ice zombies and dragons and all the magic stuff. What people love about Game of Thrones is the realism. It's like the battles, the drama, the family and political intrigue. And that's what Rebellion is. You have the Targaryens versus the Starks versus the Lannisters. And you have Jaime Lannister backstabbing the king, earning the nickname of the Kingslayer. You have the sack of King's Landing, where the Mountain does some certain things to a Dornish princess to set off the whole Red Viper series. Yours is all the fantasy aspects. Mine is the real nitty-gritty Game of Thrones stuff that people love.
Well, see, I'm going to come back at you with this. You're right. There's not that much fantasy in Game of Thrones, and that's why I think it would be fun to see a fantasy Game of Thrones movie, because they have kind of sidelined those elements in the TV show. I think the problem with doing a movie based on your idea, don't worry, Nick, we'll get to you. I think the problem with doing a movie based on your idea is that when I started watching Game of Thrones, I came in cold, and with a movie audience, you have to assume that not everybody who comes to your movie has seen the TV show or read the books. It took me like 2 watches of the first season and rewinding to figure out, wait, who's that? Who's that? How are they related? Targaryens and Starks and Baratheons and
Lannisters.
Nick, let me finish. Let me finish. We'll get to you. I don't think people are going to be able to follow it. I think you're right. It's drama and intrigue, but when you're just throwing people cold into this world and you're asking them to keep track of 4 different families and the feuds in between those families, and this one doesn't like that one, and this one betrays this one.
Throwing them into 8,000 years ago when there's an entirely new cast of characters is any easier to follow.
But
these are people that you know from the show, but younger versions of them. So fans of the show will be able to follow what's going on. Ice Wall and the Ice Zombies is going to be a 24 different names to learn and their backstories.
It's going to be a new movie. That's what I'm saying. You don't need to have any knowledge of Game of Thrones because this is a story we haven't seen before. You don't have to know the show. You just need to see Braveheart with zombies, which is basically what this show is.
I'd rather see a movie that deepens my appreciation of the series than an entirely new thing that just has Game of Thrones name stamped on it. That's like a generic fantasy quest.
You would, but most moviegoers wouldn't. That's what I'm saying.
As a Game of Thrones fan,
you would like it, but I'm saying the average moviegoer is going
to
want
to Game of Thrones movie for fans and to introduce people to this world, not something completely unrelated that takes place
like
at the
Westeros?
Wall. Like Westeros?
Yeah, let's talk about
Let me go first. Here's the thing about both your ideas. It's all stuff I already know watching the show. It's stuff you learn already. Nothing is different. Like, you're just telling a story that I've heard. Like, and also, nothing that you can't be just a flashback in an episode. You could do a whole flashback episode for either idea and then move on. Or, you know, for your idea, 15 minutes of a flashback. Like, it doesn't take in, like, the scope of a movie, or it doesn't try to do anything different or push the boundaries like Gurr of Thrones.
So first of all, do you honestly think that the ultimate Game of Thrones spinoff movie is a parody animated movie with first of all, Peter Dinklage voicing Sir Pounce makes no sense because he's already a character on the show, so that's confusing.
Is it?
Yeah, it's really confusing.
Yours has no plot. What are they trying to do?
Unite the Seven Animal Kingdoms.
But the Seven Animal Kingdoms don't exist.
It's not even Game of Thrones.
Jones movie. It's
back
a parody
to Spencer
movie.
Versus Dan.
Whoa, whoa. I'm sorry, but neither of these ideas are. Both of these ideas are boring as hell.
They're not.
They're not boring.
I already know.
Here's what you don't already know.
You're doing everything that you. I've already. I know so much about the Star.
I've kept something in the chamber that you don't already know that neither the book readers or the show watchers don't know, and that is who Jon Snow's parents are.
That's
Ned Stark comes back from this rebellion with a baby, and we don't know who it was with. We don't know how he came across that baby. We just know he comes back, and he's not the kind of guy that cheats around on his wife. So who got him to do that? Or who his real parents are? That's something that we can reveal in the movie.
They're revealing that in the show, probably this season. That's going to be in the show. Nothing is like a game changer for like that would necessitate a movie. I'm sorry, neither of it.
If you put that in a movie, everyone would need to see it just to find out that crucial missing piece of information.
All right, let's see. I want final thoughts from each of you. And sure. I think you all have good had arguments, but let's hear, Spencer, why you don't like the other two and likewise with you guys.
I just think what's great about Game of Thrones is that it breaks the fantasy conventions. It has dragons and stuff in it, but it's mostly about real people getting in real problems and shattering all of our illusions about, oh, what a knight is, what nobility is, what being good and bad is. And Dan's pitch is very much taking it backwards to like a Dungeons and Dragons story, and I want to keep it Game of Thrones, keep it about politics, family, and murky moral intrigue.
Nick?
Well, I noticed you didn't criticize my idea, so that should tell you a lot.
I love it. I actually love your idea.
Look, I said it again. It's just it's flashbacks. That's all it needs. You could do 5 minutes on yours and 20 minutes on yours, and that's all you need for it. There's nothing game-changing. There's nothing pushing the boundaries. Mine, while insane, pushes the boundaries and does something completely different that no one would expect that would necessitate a movie. Yours is just flashbacks.
I mean, listen, I see where you're coming from. I think you're a little blinded by, I know that you, of the three of us, you're the biggest Game of Thrones fan. I understand that you would definitely want to see your movie as a Game of Thrones fan because it fills in these details that would richen your enhancement of the show. But I'm saying when you have a TV show that makes a jump to a movie, it needs to make a jump in scale. And yeah, people sitting in rooms and talking in political intrigue is great for television. But
this
if you're
is
talking,
a war.
But I know, but it's a lot of it you just said is political intrigue and like these families and people talking. That's great on TV. This movie, number one, fills in details that you don't know about the creation, the old days of Westeros. It's not tied into the canon and mythology of the show, so new viewers can get into it, and it's epic in scale. You have huge battles, you have White Walkers, you have, you know, the scale that the show can't do really on a TV budget, so you're taking advantage of the movie medium. Nick, your idea is half canon, half parody, and I would never see it in a movie.
Well, guys, all right. Well, you know, prequels are always great. Prequels are
always great. Mine has battles, too. It has two gigantic battles, and they're people.
I'm sure all three of these have battles.
People, oh, not time. People versus magical
but
zombies.
But you don't know who those people are. That's the
animals
problem.
Get massacred.
Yeah, no. Who doesn't want to see
cartoons?
Who
in the audience doesn't love
massacres? By the way, animals being destroyed. You guys pitch prequels?
All right.
Who gives a shit? No one likes prequels. There's never been a good prequel.
All right. Noted. Everyone's ballot is in. Okay. That was intense. I wouldn't expect anything else from our champions. Fantastic first round. Based on the arguments, I think someone clutched it in their final, and I think it was Dan Burrows!
Oh, boy!
And I think he made the best point of it allows canon because it's something further along, but then it doesn't require so much of fan service to the Dan wins.
All right.
That was a close one, though.
I would, as a fan of the show, though, Spencer, I would
You'd
go see
You'd rather see mine.
My idea is
his argument
way
about
better
the
than all of
was,
yours.
Was what put it over the edge. And yours was just crazy. I think we all, they hit pretty hard on it.
It's not crazy.
Round two. The new Deadpool movies are announced, and it will have an R rating. Thank God. So George B. on Twitter brought this one up, which I like a lot. Which movie franchise should be R-rated? We're going to have some overall like genre questions here for our champions to really debate here, and this is the first of them. But which movie franchise, if you go back and do and redo or start over, which franchise should have been rated R? And this time we're starting with you, Nick.
Cool. Well, we've seen Harry Potter in primary school and high school. Now I want to see the gang in college exploring mind-altering magic and their bodies. Now, I'm sure there is a magic college in Fort Lauderdale that they could all go to, and I'm sure there's Slytherin has a fraternity chapter. So we're going to take the sex, we're going to take super violence that always happened off-camera, lame in the movies because it was for kids, and now we're going to see people get bit by snakes, digested, heads chopped off with wands. We're going to see some people. You guys are going to be screaming, Avada Kedavra. Also, have you noticed
how hot these actors gotten. Daniel Radcliffe, Emma Watson, hell, even Neville's a piece. which is, that's why this is not just Harry Potter. This is Harry Potter meets Spring Breakers in the Wizarding world. It's gonna get hot. It's gonna get nice. It's gonna be rated R.
Scott, can you check and see if this is like an official thing in Vegas? Because I think Nick's like taking a dive or something.
Yeah, did he bet against
is
himself?
Is he the
on
favorite?
On it.
You guys wouldn't want to see a rated R Harry Potter of like wizards.
I'm sure the audience would like to see Hermione's boobs, but I don't know if that's the right thing. Hermione.
That's Hermione.
Thank you. But I think that's sorry, I don't want to see that. She's a kid.
They're 20. They're in college. This
she's
is the
all
college
grown
version.
Now.
All right.
That was great.
Got your pitch. Thanks, Nick. Dan.
Squares.
This is going to be a tough job all day following him. for completely different reasons, I'm saying The Hunger Games, not because I want to see boobs. I think it's becoming clear, especially as the movies progress, that the actions of the characters, particularly Katniss, are a result of the trauma that she's experienced going through these games, which we told are the most brutal things in the world. The problem with the Hunger Games movies is because they want to retain the 12-year-old audience, they're rated PG-13, which I get the motivation behind, but I don't think the story itself, and it's getting more bloody and action-oriented as it goes, the story itself doesn't have as much impact when it's PG-13 because you don't really see any of the brutality of what's happening. I think a problem that we had when we were doing the Honest Trailer and that we've discussed with Mockingjay Part 1 is Katniss is so, like, you know, shell-shocked. But it doesn't. You don't really get why, because I think that the franchise has been watered down. And so I think from a storytelling point of view, The Hunger Games suffers because it's not allowed to be as brutal as it can be, especially when you've got kids involved. I mean, the MPAA is really restrictive on that kind of stuff. So, you know, is it going to be rated R? No, but, you know, I think it should be, especially as we get into the later movies, because you're doing the story a disservice by watering it down.
Spencer, what's your pick?
I think what should be rated R is the new rebooted Planet of the Apes franchise. This is all about the line between animal and man and how blurry that line gets when civil society collapses. So they're already on a crossing paths. You want to see the apes get more and more civilized, but you want to see man really descend into savagery. And I think that it fits the story. This is a story for adults already. You're not freaking out little kids when you show gore and nudity and cursing and violence. This is based on a property that came out when?
1968, April 3rd.
Wow.
Thank you very much, Movie Man.
They planned that.
That's awesome. So this is for grown-ups. It's grown-up source material. These are grown-up themes, and amping up the sex and violence with on the human side actually makes a lot of sense for the franchise.
See, here's my problem with both things. Like, if you made it rated R, it wouldn't be that much different than what it already is. It would just be a little bit more violent. It would be a little bit more traumatic. Mine, put in rated R thing, changes the game for a movie. These kids grew up with this. They're in college. Let them see their heroes go through college things.
And first of all, there's no wizard college.
Is there? I don't know.
No, there's not.
Hogwarts is like finishing school. But yeah, I mean, the movie's got pretty dark.
Which franchise existing should be R? You're
Harry
Potter.
Pitching
a future franchise of
this is a complete spinoff.
This is a spinoff. So now I'm confused with your stances, because if you're pitching the movies that existed as Harry Potter, they'd be kids going through elementary and high school.
And then to college.
But they don't go to college in the movies.
They
finish school and fight Voldemort. So that's, you're pitching, that's not really what the question asked, but I'm just verifying. Is that what you're saying?
I mean, I'm putting them in college. I'm putting them in college.
Okay, all right.
Work great for Saved by the Bell.
Poor children that have to watch R-rated Harry Potter.
They're not kids anymore. They're
so
adults.
You're telling the same stories, but they're not in grade school. They're in college.
Yeah, they're adults now.
Okay,
they're adults now.
Okay.
And they're not kids anymore. They're going through the same things. They want to see I'm a 20-year-old, 22-year-old in college. I grew up with Harry. I want to see what Harry's doing at 22.
Dan and Spencer, let's hear your
it's
guys
like going
again.
To see a porno star in the Goonies. It's just weird.
It's not porno.
It's just weird.
Stop being a Puritan.
Well, okay.
You did say it was hot sex and love.
Yeah, well, it's college.
And they're like kids. So
they're 22 years old.
Wizard drugs or something?
Dan and Spencer, let's hear you guys tackle
you
each other.
I just want to hear more from Nick. But in response to The Hunger Games, I think that, yes, they are glossing over the horrors of war. But the thing about that franchise is it's really not about The Hunger Games, and it's not about oppressive governments. It takes those things and uses them as a backdrop for a love triangle. These movies are about Katniss and PETA and Gale. They're not really about the Hunger Games. So just adding a bunch of gore to the side of that, I don't think it improves the story. I think you have the same story of where's PETA, where's PETA, where's PETA. Okay, I'll do every step I take as a character is going to be for my sort of boyfriend. That doesn't change by making an R-rated movie.
Same argument for yours. I mean, it doesn't really change the story. It just...
But at least it fits the story. At least it fits, you know, also you can have monkeys ripping people's faces off as they do in real life.
They more or less have that. I mean, like, it's pretty gory and significantly violent already.
I don't know, the human society, they just seemed a little muddy. Like, they were just...
Well, they're cowards.
They seemed like they were in good shape with Gary Oldman. They had iPads. They were all doing
I don't know what
fine.
Rated R is going to automatically be like, oh, we're not going to use our iPads anymore.
It fits with the theme of the film because it's humans descending into savagery while apes get more civilized. So an R rating would free you up to show that.
To show more of the darker human side, yes. Which we didn't see in the movie. I get
but I don't think you could still do that PG-13. You could still do that PG-13. Well, yeah, they just haven't chose to do it because they're still at the collapse of the society. They haven't gone there yet. The next movie is probably going to be that, and it's probably going to still be PG-13. I don't think that's going to change. The rated R doesn't give you license to go savagery from
sure
the humans.
Sure it does.
Sure, it does.
Well, I agree with Nick somewhat, not on the Harry Potter thing, but I agree with Nick somewhat on the fact that I think there's an R-rated version of Planet of the Apes, and I think there's a PG-13-related Planet of the Apes, and I think you can achieve the same thing with either one. The reason I went with the Hunger Games more than anything is, you know, it's not necessarily to fix the story, it's that I think the story doesn't work, and I think it's been watered down, and I think the reason that we're not really buying these characters and the Where's PETA thing, and like, why is she so hung up on PETA, is that we don't see how savage what they've gone through really is, how much the connection that they have made really is, because we don't get the full impact of what those characters have experienced, particularly in the first movie when they were all young. I mean, with the little girl getting killed, that was a bloodless death because it had to be, and I think it really took a lot out of the impact of that, and that is something that has echoed and that still affects Katniss to this day, and it's something that we don't really remember.
So you wanted to pick more child murder.
I'm saying the brutality of the story is essential to the later development of the characters, and watering that down brings us to the point we're at now. It's like, why is she so...
That's bad writing. Rated R won't fix bad writing. If it's still rated R and the same people are making those movies, it's still going to be bad because it's bad writing.
But I'm saying the writing is constricted by the rating.
I don't think so.
I think it is.
I think they're limited as to what they can do.
Would you watch? The R-rated Hunger Games or the R-rated Planet of the Apes? I'm just curious as an outsider and sitting in the middle of those two.
I guess Planet of the Apes.
Movie Mance, you had a point you were going to add.
I had a point I was going to say.
Still think my idea is the best?
1968, the first Planet of the Apes movie, which was very violent. Remember the hunt, the chase? Mm-hmm. Really violent. You know what that movie was rated?
G.
G. Whoa.
1968, that movie was rated G.
Wow.
Mine's the only one that changes the game. Like, and what deserves the rated R
There's
rating.
No, that's not even a, it's no, a different it's
what,
game, Nick.
No, it's what deserves the rated R rating.
Mine is also the only one that doesn't cut out the movie's fan base from seeing the movie.
I disagree.
14-year-old girls like the Hunger Games children, I guess the college years. I don't know what we're talking about.
These kids are now in college.
They'll bring their parents more money for the Hunger Games people.
All right, this is really close, but I'm going to play my cards out. Your idea is just wonkos, and I don't even think you really know the franchise because they're in high school, so why would they be in college? It just doesn't make any sense, so I'm just sort of discrediting you for those reasons, sadly. So back to now to final arguments for Dan and Spencer, because you both have equally been jabbing each other, I think, with very fair points I've been noting, so I just need one little final push here and give me your closing arguments.
Planet of the Apes is a franchise for grown-ups, so make it rated R.
Planet of the Apes, I think, is looking to expand its base right now. I don't think it needs to restrict itself to grown-ups, and I think the Hunger Games suffers because they have to water down events that impact the characters later in the story.
I don't think either changes.
Okay, this is tough. You both did it, but I was leaning away, and then I came another way, and the thing that swayed me was Hunger Games isn't for grown-ups, and you're going to lose that base, and they're not going to see it, and it's so successful. Why would they want to lose that base that is coming to the movie? Spencer's argument won it!
Fair enough. On the
board. That was tight. That was really tight.
That was great.
That was a good fight. Good Sorry, fight. Nick. Look, I just didn't even
don't
understand.
Don't apologize.
It's like, what are you doing?
I'm changing.
I don't want to watch those kids have sex.
Why not?
This is creepy. Round three.
Your wand is showing.
All right. It was announced this week that Joss Whedon will not be directing Avengers Infinity War 1 and 2. The Russo brothers. Hey, Russo brothers, we love you.
Woo.
Come on the show.
Thanks for watching.
They'll
don't go outside the box because it's frowned upon.
They like honest trailers, so I like they're doing Infinity War. But anyway, what should Josh Whedon's next? I keep saying it wrong. Josh. I know the name. I know it's not. This isn't Blumkamp.
Mr. Whedon.
What would Mr. Whedon's next movie? What should it be? That's fight number three. And we'd like, clearly, it could be a franchise, a sequel, an adaptation of something, or original concept. What should Joss do next? And Dan, you're starting this round.
This was really tough because he hasn't done that many movies. And I thought about a lot of stuff, and what I landed on is that if J.J. Abrams can go from Star Trek to Star Wars, Joss Whedon can go from the Avengers to the Justice League. Ooh. I want to see Joss Whedon's Justice League. I was looking at some research, and somebody actually asked him at a convention, I think right around the time the Avengers was coming out, they said, what advice would you have for DC building the Justice League? And he said, call me. I think basically saying, like, it's very complicated, and you really need to know your stuff.
I think it means they screwed me over with Wonder Woman. I can tell you a bunch of shit why I don't like working
Nick,
with
can
them.
You le- can you allow me to I just you let me get finish
through.
My
I
argument?
I just want to get that through.
You know, Joss Whedon was working on a Wonder Woman movie for a while. Thank you, Nick. So he's already familiar with the characters, and I think that this DC universe, whether or not it's actually in trouble, there's a perception that it's in big trouble. There's a lot of skepticism in the fan community about the Justice League movie. I think bringing Joss Whedon on to kind of shepherd it will give that the direction that it needs, because right now the perception of it is that it's completely directionless, and you know who better to bring over and do the Justice League than someone who successfully threaded the needle with Marvel and the Avengers to bring him on board and put him in charge of it.
Spencer, what's your take?
All right, I think Joss should do a proper adaptation of The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. What do I mean by that? I mean it should be funny. This is one of the funniest books ever written. Why was the movie not a comedy? This is where Joss comes in. We know he's a great sci-fi and action director, but I think his one elite skill is dialogue, is injecting funny dialogue into these sci-fi action movies. And the best moments from the Avengers are like the laugh lines. It's the puny god moment. It's everything Tony Stark says. It's the shawarma scene. Him injecting that kind of humor, matching up the best sci-fi comedy director of all time with the best sci-fi comedy book of all time is why I'm pitching Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
Nick?
Mr. Whedon had created Buffy, Angel. He wrote Toy Story. He created Firefly, Dr. Horrible, and he wrote Cabin in the Woods. These are all original projects from Joss Whedon. And now he is going to make $1 billion movie and then make a second $1 billion movie with the Avengers. He needs to make an original concept. All these projects before came from, you know, he had to scrimp and use CWWB money and just scrimp and try to get squeeze any penny he could get. This guy is a hot commodity that any studio would throw hundreds of million dollars at. Let's see his imagination go wild with like studio support and let him make something brand new and original, because you know he can do it. And also,
well, what is he making?
I'm not smart enough to come up with a Joss Whedon.
Yeah, I feel like that's kind of a cop out.
Yeah.
So you're not pitching a movie.
It's original. I can't pitch an original Joss Whedon concept. He's better than me. He's making an adventure.
I want to change my pitch to a great movie. Yeah. He should make a great movie next.
I think it's a fair answer. I think he's saying I want whatever Joss Whedon.
I don't care what it is. I want
his movie.
So we're arguing against the field.
You guys had the same chance to pick that idea.
Right.
I don't think that's
right. Andy's idea there.
Okay, let's start nitpicking. No, I want to see. Also, with so many damn reboots and comic book movies out, I want something brand new and original. I don't know what that is. We've done your movie. Granted, it was a failure. He would do a better job. And he tried to do the Warner Brothers DC movie. It didn't work out. He doesn't like them. Let's just do something original. Let's do something fun. Give him $300 million to make whatever he wants, and I'm sure it's going to be fantastic.
That's a total cop-out, Nick.
No, it's not.
No, it really is. I can just say, like, what should Joss Whedon make next?
Oh,
a really good original movie.
Justice League's not a cop-out? Justice League's not a cop-out?
Nick, this is the championship round. You're not here to give cop-out answers. You're here to think critically about movies.
And I'll go with Justice League. Oh, because he's done other comic book movies, so I'll do another comic book movie. That's easy.
But you don't even have to back up your answer because you don't have one.
Because I'm not Joss Whedon.
All right, hold on. I want to get
sorry,
the moving answer, but hold on. To be clear, I think his answer's fine. I get what he's suggesting.
It's fine.
Let's discredit that. We got to move on. He's suggesting he could have pitched an original concept, But he's saying, I don't care what the original concept is.
Yes,
I want whatever Joss Whedon has in his head.
Because my idea.
That's what you picked.
Yeah,
right?
That's why he's doing the Avengers.
If any
and
of you had
it.
Picked it, we would have flipped a coin. You would have been
I would have cared. I would have cared because I fight the argument.
You have some cleanup.
Does it matter that Zack Snyder is already confirmed to direct the Justice League?
Yeah, no, because right, also, no, we're going to have to reboot the whole thing. Because
they could fire him and they're not shooting it yet.
And
right?
Then you
we're allowing that answer. That's a fine thing. Okay. Now we know our stance is what we're fighting here.
It's okay.
Cop out or not. I think Dan's just mad he didn't
think answer of it. To your question, no, the answer to your question is in the question. It says, pitch his next movie, original concept? You just looked at the question and said, yeah, that looks good.
No, I didn't. I went with the not Pat answer of, oh, yeah, he should do Justice League, because that's the other thing that's happening. And then I
that's not my argument at all.
No, he should do, because other comic book movies.
You're telling me, as down on DC as you are, that you wouldn't be happy if Joss Whedon went to do the
No,
the
I would
Justice
absolutely.
League.
No, I'm picking. I want him to do something that he only he knows. Something that he's thought about for 20 years that he's never been able to do because he's never had the budget. And I want him to do that dream project.
I think he did. It was like a word for word Shakespeare.
No,
remake.
He made that with Pocket Change. He had. I want to see him make whatever dream movie he's had in his head since he was a kid that he would need to spend $300 million
because that's never gone wrong. Give a director a blank check and say do whatever you want. That's always gone right.
They did that with the Avengers.
Why are you guys, do you guys oppose to him doing that?
Joss doing something original?
His Interstellar? I mean, his
Exactly.
Interstellar?
His Interstellar.
Inception is what I actually meant to say because that was what he did off of Dark Knight.
Well, I think his best work is actually off of the existing properties. It's Buffy and the Avengers.
He created Buffy.
He did create Buffy.
He did create Buffy.
The movie.
He sure wasn't a comic book.
He wrote the movie.
No, he wrote and then the movie.
I stand corrected.
Before the comic book, Movie Mance?
Yes.
Buffy, why? Comic or movie first?
No, it wasn't a comic.
And then he co-wrote Cabin in the Woods with
Drew Goddard, right?
Yeah. But in reference to the Justice League, that's a crazy tonal shift to go from the DC movies that have been setting up the Justice League, then to go to a Joss Whedon like Marvel wisecracking fun world.
It's
going
to
be
reboot
like
it again.
You have to start from scratch. I mean, if you go from Man of Steel, Dawn of Justice, and then Justice League, it's going to be like, what happened? Why are there colors? Why is everyone smiling?
You have to give him credit for being able to direct in more than one tone. He can direct, you know, Serenity wasn't bright colors and, you know, I mean, you could just
but
because...
But it was still witty and fun. And,
well, yeah, and that's, and DC doesn't have to be. What have we been saying about all these movies is like, they're dry, they're dull, they're boring, there's no fun. And I'm not saying it has to become bright, primary colored Avengers, but you bring in somebody who can inject just a tiny bit of fun and somebody who can connect. That's what he does. He excels when he's working with ensembles, when he's working with a large group of people. You bring him in to guide this and try to figure out how to make this from just being the biggest drag in the world, which is what it looks like it might be going toward. Plus, I mean, just from a public standpoint, right now, I think that with this whole Justice League thing, especially with their hardcore fans, they're on the ropes with this, and they could really use Joss Whedon to get people back under the tent and back and saying, okay, this might work, and I think it would produce a better movie than Zack Snyder's Justice League.
Just to be clear, you're using the exist. So this is coming off Batman, Superman, Snyder's. You would have Joss then do Justice League after using.
I would have Joss kind of guide them from here, culminating in the Justice League.
That's
movie.
Just wasting
Batman's
his talent.
Superman's already shot. So I'm just being clear.
I'm not saying you have to retroactively change that the Batman versus Superman is in the books. I think that's money in the bank. I think that you bring Joss on to get the Justice League in a position where that movie, at least, is not going to be disappointing, despite the fact that the road there might be a little rough.
I mean, it would fit with what DC's done so far because it sounds super desperate to bring Joss Whedon on board at the last minute to try to fix that crumbling house.
I don't want to waste his talents fixing anything. I want his talents going to create a brand new universe, a brand new franchise, something based not on a graphic novel, something based on something in his brain that...
Yeah, so do you guys have thoughts on why you don't want to see that as his next thing?
Well, I do, yeah. I think that some of the most disappointing films that you see from great directors, and Tarantino, Nolan with Interstellar, is when they get to a point where the studio says, here's a blank check, do what you want, we're not going to say anything, and then they don't have... That's the thing. People think that just because you're talented that you don't need people there that are saying... You might want to rethink this, or Shyamalan ran into that with Lady in the Water, where he got to the point where he's just like, I can do whatever I want. He didn't listen to what people said, and he made one of the worst movies ever. So I actually don't want to see Joss Whedon just given a blank check and told to do what you want.
You can't blame other failures, like, you know, you can't blame other people's failures, you know, for not giving him
but
a chance.
But Nick, what I'm saying is that creative, just because you're great and creative doesn't necessarily mean that you should be given a blank check and told to do what you want, because...
It's worth the risk.
I don't think the creative process works that way necessarily. I think you need checks and balances.
Yeah, we have no evidence that Joss Whedon is an auteur. He's a good writer and a good director, but he's never had full control over something without a lot of talented collaborators. So it's tough to argue. That's a web series.
That's a sing-along blog.
Still great. I'm just saying, you expand that out.
It's tough to argue against an original movie. So I'll just say, in support of The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, when this got the guy that directed the first one had only made music videos. He had never worked with actors before. So pairing that up, the source material deserves another chance.
Anyone
would be better.
So you would be better.
I would be better.
Okay, then fine.
And then
you to do
the
that,
source material is amazing. It deserves another chance, and it's a perfect fit for me.
All right. We need to wrap this one up. Movie Mates, quick cleanup.
Garth Jennings directed Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy poorly. I'm with you, brother.
Yeah, thanks, man.
Okay, so closing arguments here so I can try and find something here to declare a winner, because I think all three of these are interesting choices. But let's start with you, Dan. Closing thoughts.
I just, regardless, I just don't think Nick's answer is... first of all, I think it's a bad idea to give somebody, free reign to do whatever you want. Plus, I think the answer is kind of a cop-out. Spencer, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy... Again, it might be a good adaptation, but I think he should really tackle something that we already know needs some work, and something that, if it is disappointing, is really going to crater a lot of people's hopes and expectations for some of their favorite characters.
Nick?
I don't want to waste Joss Whedon's time fixing Calamity, and I don't want him to, I think I would rather see him make his own Hitchhiker's Guide than doing someone else's property. And he has a track record for creating original content that people love. Let's give him a budget. He doesn't have to have carte blanche, but give him follow studio rules, but give him the budget that he's never had before on an original idea.
Spencer?
Okay. I mean, we know there's an appetite for witty sci-fi space adventures with Guardians of the Galaxy and with the Avengers. And we know there's an appetite now for witty, kooky British stuff like Doctor Who and Sherlock. And The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy is a perfect blend of that. And Joss Whedon is the perfect director for it because he can get the humor across in the dialogue of what should be a comedy first.
Wow, this is tough. Any other add? You're good. Okay. I kind of declare it based on, it's a surprise to me as well, but I think I got to go with what Dan's calling a cop-out, but I don't think is, and I think that's based on a track record. Based on a track record of a lot of original things he's done.
I have too much humility.
It'd be interesting
to
see what he does next.
Your answer was a good movie.
Hey, now you know how I feel about Harry Potter and Game of Thrones.
I think he also hit both the reasons why both yours aren't important as well, just to be clear. So Nick gets the point.
Fair enough.
Hey, I'd rather win on Game of Thrones.
That
wasn't happening.
All right, quiet. I wouldn't want a championship any other way. We're going to be way long in this episode, and we already have a tie.
We're going to take a break?
Round four, no breaks. Let's try and truck through this. Round four, Longest Ride opens this weekend, the romantic novel by Nicholas Sparks that I'm sure we're all very excited about. I don't even know which two hot people are in this one. I've lost track.
I am. I have the one.
Do you know Movie Mans?
That would be Britt Robertson and Scott Eastwood, who you're probably following.
I don't know who either of those people are.
Scott Eastwood. Maybe you know his father.
Yes. Huge on Vine.
Got it. Okay.
I bet one of them dies.
Good for them. One of them probably does. Fight Four, based off that, what's the best fictional world to have a first date in? Fun question.
Yeah.
If we could take a date in a fictional world, where would we go? And we're going to start with you, Spencer.
All right. What do you want on a first date? You want fun? You want positivity? You want to carpe your diem? So I'm going to Ferris Bueller's Day Off's Chicago. This is the city as a fantasy playground.
So Chicago.
Well, it's not exactly Chicago because it's 70 degrees and clear during the school year. You can joyride a Ferrari, go to the Cubs game, art gallery, fancy restaurant, and never pay for anything, and never get caught for anything, and then lip sync on top of a parade float and have everyone magically know the coordinated dance that you're doing. You're getting laid after that first date in Ferris Bueller, Chicago.
I would just like to point out that we're criticizing our concepts of love. So that's what we're about to do, which I'm fine with.
What?
Okay, Nick, what are you picking?
I want to take his fantasy level, Ferris Bueller, and crank it up a notch. That's why we're going to Neverland. Peter Pan's Neverland. Because not only can you fly, you never age, you can hang out with cool people and fairies that are magic, you can imagine anything you want, and it will happen. How great is that? Your date's
Wait, how does it that
I
happen?
I don't think that happens in Neverland.
No, it does. You imagine you want to play to roses are going to happen.
you can kick some pirate ass and show the girl you're tough, and then afterwards you can go up to a kick-ass treehouse and then bangarang. Okay. Peter Pan is the place to be. It's you can. I'm sorry, but none of your dates are gonna be able to fly.
You haven't even heard mine yet.
Can you fly?
No.
All right, there you go. What girl doesn't love to fly, feel fancy free? You have a good wingman named Tinkerbell, who if it's going wrong, she can throw some powers and then make everything fit.
Aren't you surrounded by children?
No.
This is the weirdest. We've had an animated Game of Thrones, a porno Harry Potter, and now a Neverland.
Not a porno Harry Potter, it's sexuality. I'm sorry if that scares you, Dan.
Dan, what's your pick before we throw down?
Why bring the girl a box of chocolates when you can take her to where the chocolate is made? Willy Wonka's Chocolate Factory.
She's going
to
die.
I mean, let him say his piece.
How awesome would it be? First of all, it's like a land of enchantment. If you're not a messed up person, you don't die. It's only if you have like, well, that's the other thing. If the date's going badly, you just tell the Oompa Loompas what her character flaw is, and she's out of there.
1 out of 5 chance you'll die.
No, that's the movie. That's not this date. This date is a nice, you know. And that, by the way, I'm talking about Gene Wilder's Factory. None of this Johnny Depp nonsense. Yeah. No. I'm talking about the 1970s.
Noted.
Chocolate Factory. Unless you're a terrible Nick, please let me talk. Unless you're a terrible human being, you make it to the end of the Chocolate Factory. Charlie's a good guy, and you know, if you pick the right person, then you should make it to the end. If she doesn't make it to the end, well, then maybe you shouldn't have been on a date with her anyway. You've got everything you want. You've got the big chocolate, you know, room where you can eat everything. I know that people are going to say that boat down the tunnel is terrifying. It's like taking a girl to see a scary movie on the first date. She goes in a little closer. She holds your hand. You get on the end. You get to the end. You get gobstopper. You leave. I think it's a great first date. And like I said, if she's not a good person, she doesn't come out. You shouldn't have been on a date with her anyway.
Well, Dan, you know what the last thing is that a girl wants to do on a first date? Is stuff her face with food.
No, then she doesn't have to.
She doesn't have to. You're torturing her. You're putting her in front of all the chocolate in the world, all the candy, and saying,
who eats on a date?
You don't go out to eat on a date?
No, but you eat a Caesar
girls
salad.
Girls order like a salad, and they're like, take a bite, and they're like, I'm full.
You eat a Caesar salad.
You're putting a girl in front of a chocolate waterfall.
No. But if you don't want to eat it, you don't want to eat it. You're telling me that the surroundings themselves aren't enchanted enough?
If the date doesn't work out, she will die.
No one died. I said they don't come out. Nobody died in Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. They got taught a lesson.
Nobody actually died in Willy Wonka.
They were horribly disfigured.
They got sucked up by a big thing from a chocolate pool.
PTSD,
but you never saw anybody die.
No one died.
We see them not die.
Wait, no one died.
Exited stage right.
They rolled by.
He literally said, if she's good, she'll make it through the factory.
He got sucked into a chocolate river. How do we know he didn't drown?
Well, how do you know he did?
You didn't know that he did drown.
I'm sure he was fished out by an Oompa Loompa.
Willy Wonka does his little whistle thing, and he's like, Mr. Gloop will be let out in the so-and-so.
Yeah, okay, I've never said this before, but me and Spencer can finish the debate.
No, you can't.
Well, I don't care if it's Tim Burton's version or Gene Wilder. You still have creepy Oompa Loompas falling around everywhere singing. And
those guys like
dance.
The party.
Again,
they will neg the
Oompa
shit out of your
Oompa head. Loompas aren't showing up unless there's something terribly bad.
Are we sure?
If the date goes bad, they're going to be Oompa Loompa Doopity Doo. Dan ruined the date. Now we have to get rid of you.
I'm just saying.
Why won't you stop crying? Listen to me.
All right, hold on. Shut the. I'm just saying, why spend 2 years in a bad relationship if you got a filter right there that'll tell you if she's a bad person?
Yes, all men.
That is so cruel.
Spencer.
Or vice versa. Maybe you're the bad person. I don't know.
Spencer,
I like the mind's grounded in reality because the attention will be well, more so than Neverland and the Chocolate Factory. Because her attention's going to be focused on you, not thinking about, oh my God, I'd really like to eat, but I can't. And not, oh my God, we're surrounded by children and pirates. What's going on? You want the attention on you. You want to be the cool guy. You want to be Ferris Bueller showing her the time of her life.
Except your wingman is a manic depressive, and my wingman is a fairy that can make magic happen and get us to fly and dance and sing.
Well, the wingman is your out if the date isn't going well. At least you're with your best friend who has a cool car.
Here's the problem. Tinkerbell hated. These two are worried about their outs on their date. I'm not, because this date's going to be great, because we're going to live forever. We're going to have fun. We're going to fight pirates.
Hey, and
we're
going to have... Can you help bring up the rules of Neverland? Because he's making it sound like anything happened.
I'm sorry, but did not Robin Williams imagine food? And then he ate, like, multicolored pie? And ribs?
Yes, let's eat pie with children.
Great first of all, date.
Shows you're good with kids.
Tinkerbell hated Wendy and tried to kill her.
I'm not bringing Wendy.
Secondly, you want to hit me for my place being dangerous? Neverland is the most dangerous place in the world. You got rogue crocodiles. You have pirates that will literally gut you.
Cartoon pirates.
And nothing can go wrong. Wait, in Ferris Bueller's cartoons? Chicago.
Yeah, like
this
yeah.
is a cartoon Neverland.
Yeah, no violence has ever happened in, except to the pirates in. And Rufio.
I don't.
But Rufio was a dick.
Wait, but is it a cartoon or not now?
It's Peter Pan. Book?
Any version of Neverland.
Yeah.
So it's but we all know that there's children and pirates involved.
All right. Yeah. As fun as this is, I'm going to call it.
Oh my God.
I'm already making a decision. Movie Mans, unless you have anything else to add.
I'm good.
Okay. I think.
You want to go to Chicago or the Hellscape?
I think,
or have some fun.
I think there's only. Weirdly enough, there's one argument that was the most formal out of these, and that's sadly, I think, what's going to pull it.
Yeah.
And that's Spencer
Thank
Chicago.
You. That one got away from me.
Neverland, you don't know the rule. It's all over the place. And I think the salad, no one wants to eat chocolate on a first date, is a very valid
oh
point
my God, the
that
poor
Spencer
girl.
Gets the win for.
I pulled off that girl does not,
oh, my God, I want to eat
to a candy
food,
factory.
And I'm going to get fat to my first date.
Nick, you almost got me to say the F word on this show.
Yes, movie man.
Score update. Spencer is in lead with two, and you got Nick and Dan with one each.
Right. Wow.
Very good, Spencer.
Turning the corner.
Round
Here
five.
We go.
Since this is the champion round, we asked, obviously, on Twitter, a lot of just overall epic questions worthy of you guys. So this is another one that we just pulled at a random. At Porkovs asked us, what movie character would you like to see a prequel movie to? I think this is a fun one. So we usually don't like prequels, but let's figure out what's the good prequel. What's a character that deserves a little bit more backstory? And Nick, you are starting us.
If we have to do a prequel, I want to choose my favorite character, one of my favorite characters in cinema history, and that's Doc Brown.
Ooh.
We know what happened before 1955. We know what happened after 1985. We even know what happened in 1885. But I want to find out what happened in those interesting years between 1955 and 1985, and how he built the time machine, and how did he end up in Libya? What's the real reason he used the DeLorean? And ultimately ends with him befriending Marty. I almost think it's like a Forrest Gump type movie, but good. As Doc travels the world over 30 years, finding pieces of the technology and learning how to build the time machine, while also interacting with people and changing their lives and also history. Like, he probably created the internet. He probably was the founder of the original iPod. He probably designed the bullet that may the magic bullet that may have killed JFK that caused all the bullets.
Is this the same person who pitched Whiskeros?
Yeah.
This is not a bad idea.
No, it's a great idea. So
feels well thought out.
And someone's going
I'm shocked. I was expecting John McClane to be
honest.
You're
throwing this whole thing.
No, yeah. And someone wants to know. I just have brilliant ideas and I'm misunderstood in my own time. Now you're going to ask, who's going to play Christopher Lloyd? Well, here's the thing. I'm just going to get out of the way. It's going to be Christopher Lloyd. Because, hold on.
You had us, Nick.
Nope, I know. It's going to come up. No one else, I thought about this hard. No one else could play him.
He's really old right now.
But technology has gone to the point where with makeup and effects.
Benjamin Button.
It will work because no one else, who else could play him? I thought about this for a while. I stayed up all night thinking.
I'm sure someone.
Nope. Doc Brown is played by Christopher Lloyd, and he will say Christopher Lloyd, and if that costs me the point, it's worth it because I want Christopher Lloyd as Doc Brown in this fantastic movie that you admit that you love.
Movie Mance?
He's 77 years old.
So
so that makes him, what, 30 so years older?
You're just doing so well, Nick. Are you sure you want to keep that on the point?
Yeah, because I'm going with it. I'm going with my sword.
I'm sure he has a son or something, maybe?
Not as talented as him.
I don't know him, but okay. All right, Dan, what's your pick?
You had me in the line.
Yeah, you had me till Chris Lloyd.
Even awards
so
you.
I think that one of the best movie characters of the last 15 years, and really I don't know how long, and the best part of the movie he was in was Christoph Waltz's Hans Landa from Inglourious Basterds. I think that you saw him at a time, of course, when he was in the Nazi regime, but at the end of the movie, he really proved himself to be not so much a Nazi as an opportunist, a guy who's really, really smart, who's obviously a world traveler, can speak all of these different languages, and is really just a compelling character and interesting to watch. Like, I couldn't take my eyes off the movie when I was watching Inglourious Basterds, and I would like to see, I don't think that Hans Landa's story leading up to Inglourious Basterds was him growing up in Germany and just immediately joining the Nazi party. I'd like to see where his character came from, the fact that he kind of plays people against each other. He goes with the wind and he, you know, joins in where it's convenient for him. They take it as far as he can go, and then he jumps ship and goes where the next opportunity is. So I think there's kind of like a world European traveler con man kind of movie to be had with Hans Landa, and I would like to see his backstory. And Christoph Waltz, I think, is still of an appropriate age that he could still play the character you know, 10, 15 years younger.
Wait, you just gave him a shrug that he couldn't do that?
No, I just don't think it's, I don't think that matters. Okay. I don't think that matters.
All right. All right, Spencer, what's your pick?
I'm going to go with Dumbledore, and I hate how similar this is going to sound to an R-rated Harry Potter, but here we go. What do you guys know about the Global Wizarding War?
Not much. Sure they probably went to teach us?
I will.
I'm sure they probably went to college in Miami.
They went to Hogwarts. So it's the 1940s. Young Dumbledore is rising through the ranks as a teacher at Hogwarts. Meanwhile, a dark wizard of the same age named Grindelwald is waging war against the Muggle world secretly during World War II. So this is canon, according to J.K. Rowling. This is where Dumbledore really made a name for himself. She indicated as much that Grindelwald is Magic Hitler, basically. He is a Nazi wizard working during World War II, and Dumbledore was the only wizard powerful enough to stop him. So it's Harry Potter set against a historical fiction background, and I forgot to mention this, but Grindelwald, also mentioned by J.K. Rowling, is the gay lover of Dumbledore, as indicated, that Dumbledore was, as we know, a homosexual, and he had gay relationships, and this was with this evil wizard, or who turned evil after they broke up.
So a grown-up movie.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah.
Oh, I wonder how those are frowned upon.
Yeah, it's a grown-up movie. Oh, I think it could be PG-13, but it is aimed at grown-ups.
Because that's what Harry Potter is, aimed at grown-ups.
Okay, just two notes here. Christoph Waltz is 58 years old.
That's old as shit.
And Christopher Lloyd, interesting, married 4 times, no kids.
Yeah.
Okay. So his kid couldn't play it. Okay, yes. Interesting. All right, go ahead, battle, guys.
So Christopher Lloyd, Nick, I was sitting here trying to think of defenses for that answer, and you gave it to me, which is that we've seen Doc Brown in 1985, and we've seen him in 1955, and he looks 30 years younger than he looks now. Christopher Lloyd, I love him. He can't play that role and be the same character that we've already seen him play as the same age as he was 30 years ago. He just... That's what kills it for me.
I'm not so upset with that, because you can... The continuity isn't that important, but it's like... He's a great, not a second banana, but you need him to play off of someone. You need the Marty with Doc, and it's just him on his own.
The whole world is Marty. I mean, he's going to be interacting with different people, notable people, famous people. Maybe he meets the grandfather of Marty McFly. The whole world is his Marty. And he can play off of everyone. I think it's just a really fun story of seeing that decade, which is an interesting decade.
Which 30 years. It's tough to have a crazy person as a protagonist.
I don't think so, because I think it proved in Back to the Future 3, he was more or less the lead, and that's the superior sequel. He's done it before. Mm-hmm. And Christopher Lloyd's a great actor. So, that's not a problem at all. I just want to see... one of my favorite parts was, growing up as a kid, was watching how the time machine came together, because it's so many different parts. It's so piecemeal. Let's see how that... all comes together. That's such an interesting
but
story.
But you still are insisting on Christopher Lloyd and young person
makeup. If that's a problem,
makeup.
Cast someone else. That's a problem, cast someone else.
Now you're having your...
I think he sees the way the wind's blowing.
No, I don't... honestly, it's not that big of a deal to me. But I think the story is so much more interesting, which you guys all admit, because your jaws were dropped.
We were just more shocked that you prepared something.
Yeah.
I prepared all of this.
All right, interesting. What about the other two? Yeah.
I've seen the Con Man movie. I've seen that movie. It's kind of like Talented Mr. Ripley, played by a German guy.
That's how you perceive it. That's not how it is.
Mine's a better version of it, but it's not a bad idea. I think it's cool. I just don't straight up.
Okay, cool, great.
All right, Dan, thoughts?
I think that Hans Landa is such an interesting character. I think of the three of these characters, he's the most interesting and the most compelling to watch. And I think he's played by the original actor, that role, he won an Oscar for it, and it's such a great role. For me, aside from the Christopher Lloyd thing, which I guess is off the table now, he invented a time machine. Is it that interesting watching him travel in the world to get a bumper and a vent?
It's shaping the world. He's one of the most brilliant cinematic minds ever created.
But what's the emotional drive for it? Otherwise, he's just building a machine. What's the emotion that's driving him to do that?
Wasn't the time machine the first thing he made that worked? Wasn't he kind of a crappy scientist before the time machine? Is it just 30 years of him? Is it 30 years
and
of
that,
him failing?
And exactly, that 30-year journey is him becoming a crappy scientist and becoming this fantastic scientist. Who knows? Maybe he helped build, weaponry and
That movie just verified that is true, right?
That is true. The flux capacitor, that's what makes time travel possible.
And that bump on the head set.
That bump on the head.
That the events in 1955 set him off that he can do it, and then he had this dream, and we're going to see this dream come true. This 30-year journey.
I guess it just doesn't really.
What about this anti-Dumbledore movie?
For me, again, it's kind of the argument you had against me with the Hunger Games, which is that it. I just don't see it speaking to the audience that it's aimed at. I don't think people really want to see Dumbledore Hitler Hunter, Magic Hitler Hunter, and I think it's just so tonal. It's so tonally different from everything else in Harry Potter that for me it would seem like an odd man out. It's in a completely different world, in a completely different realm, and I just don't see
it is a definite tonal shift, but this hopefully will do for Harry Potter what X-Men First Class did for the X-Men, which grounds it in historical events and introduces it to a new generation of fans. And yours, at least in mine, you're cheering against the Nazis instead of cheering for a Nazi's rise to power.
Are
we supposed to support him as he works his way up the ranks?
No, that's what I.
Yes, he did it.
That's why I clarified specifically. This would not be about his rise to the Nazi Party. It would be about who this guy is and what brought him to say, I guess I got to go with these guys because that's what.
That's how you end the movie. I guess I'll be a Nazi.
Will you please let me talk? The movie.
Nick, shut up.
He's revealed to be an opportunist, which is why I agree. You don't want to see a Nazi movie for 2 hours. That would be kind of depressing. That's why I want to focus on this character and what brought him to that point. I want to see his development and how he got swept up and decided, okay, I'm going to ride with these guys until it's time to get off that train. And he does at a second's notice. So it's more developing that character. It's not about his rise through the Nazi ranks.
But Londa, Hans, the character, is cool in Inglourious Basterds. I don't want to see him before he's cool.
He's always been cool.
We don't know that.
Well, he will be in the movie.
Andy, can I say one thing about my idea?
Are you done, okay. Spencer?
Is it, then are we cheering for this cool guy who's, again, rising through the ranks of the Nazi Party but has his fingers crossed the whole time, so you're okay with it?
Why do you have to cheer for him? Did you cheer for Daniel Plainview and There Will Be Blood? You don't have to cheer for the main character of your movie. He just has to be a compelling character, which I think Hans Landa is.
I think young Dumbledore is just as compelling a character because it's a side of him we didn't know about. We know Dumbledore is this huge badass, but we didn't know how he got that way.
But what will it add to the Dumbledore that we already have? To know that he fought in World War II
and had a
boyfriend.
Yeah. Those are two things that J.K. Rowling said in interviews, but it's not in any Harry Potter book.
But we already know that, and it's just a reenactment of the things we already know, whereas the Hans Landa thing is going to fill in things.
Well, this is true of any prequel concept. We know this is true of any prequel, where they're going to end up.
Here's the thing. Here's the thing that my movie solves. They're going to make something with Back to the Future, whether it's a prequel, reboot, sequel. This is the best version of that, where it doesn't ruin what happened. It doesn't try to recreate what happened. It's enhancing what happened without shitting up like most prequels do.
That's what they said about The Hobbit, and how that worked.
No one said that about The Hobbit.
So help me here, because I'm still struggling with all three of you. But like, what is your movie if he's not the good scientist?
No, he's becoming that great scientist. His journey of developing this time machine, traveling the world, and becoming this great scientist we know he is. Because in 1955, he was terrible. 1985, he was this great, ingenious mind who stole plutonium from the Libyans. I want to see that guy, that daring, who would do something that crazy for a movie. That sounds exciting. How did he steal from the Libyans? Why did he what made him decide to use the DeLorean? Was he hanging out with John DeLorean when he was doing it? I want to see this adventure of Doc Brown becoming this great guy.
I do too, just not with 77-year-old Christopher Lloyd.
Okay, I mean, you know, let's harp on that.
Well, you said nobody else could play the part, so, I mean, we have to...
I'm sure he did take it back. Fair enough. Because these are all tough, I can only based on your arguments, and I can only base that you two seem more excited about his. Nick is the point.
Hey, good job, Nick.
Good job, Nick.
Can I take back Willy Wonka? Can we redo that round?
Round six. Yes.
One thing about the Back to the Future remakes, reboots, whatever. Bob Gale, who wrote and produced the original film,
refuses.
Said, we are never going to do a director's cut or even make a 3D version or do a reboot.
Nice.
Or change the special effects. Hero. People love them the way they are, but they are working on a Back to the Future musical.
Oh.
I'll watch that.
Stick to your guns, then. We don't need that. Round six.
Let's be civil in this one.
Gazabale on Twitter asked us for this championship question. Best movie of the 2000s. And to be clear, that's 2000 through 2015.
A century.
Best movie of the 2000s. There's a lot of them, actually, as we think about it. And we're going to start with you, Dan. What's the best movie?
Man, of all the questions we had today, this was the hardest. I could have probably picked 10 different movies. And I'm really more interested just to hear what these guys say, because I think this is actually going to be a fun conversation. I picked There Will Be Blood. I think it's an incredible movie. I think that, again, as I referenced with the Hans Landa thing, I think that Daniel Plainview is the best character that we've had since 2000, and I think it's the best performance on film that we've had since 2000. And it's just, to me, it's a perfect movie. It's a three-hour-long movie that feels like it's 90 minutes. It's both tied to a connected time and place and timeless in that, you know, it's tied to the oil fields and the turn of the century, but it's also timeless in that this is just the story of a man and arrogance and his downfall. And I think that it's just a really stunning, from the score to the cinematography, the acting, the direction, everything about that film really knocked me out. And it was a tough, tough choice, but I went with There Will Be Blood.
Good choice, Spencer.
Awesome. I went with the modern equivalent of There Will Be Blood, The Wolf of Wall Street. I think we can all agree that everything we pick is going to be well acted, well directed. It's going to be great, blah, 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 blah. What I love about this one is that Jordan Belfort, in real life, stole a lot of money from a lot of real poor people and no one cared, but you make a movie about it, and to quote the Joker, everyone loses their minds. This movie took Jonah Hill's penis and used it as a tool to get moviegoers to debate our corrupt financial services industry. I think that is a great movie that it had an impact beyond the movie itself and actually created a discussion. And I'll get into more later, but you
Nick.
Again, all great movies. My movie actually came out in the year 2000, and that movie is Christopher Nolan's Memento. This movie not only launched one of the most, probably arguably the most popular director of the century, but has one of the most intriguing, innovative storytelling techniques maybe in any film ever. The movie actually starts at the last scene of the movie.
What?
And then goes backwards.
Spoiler alert.
Well, if you haven't seen it, stop. Just watch it now. And then and then it shows the whole story goes backwards to set up where we ended up in that place. And it's not a gimmick. Everyone's just going to try to say it's a gimmick. It's not. Because it puts you in the place of Leonard, who can't form new memories. So every time you learn something new, the movie stops, goes backwards, and you are as lost as Leonard until you get to the very last scene where you see what happens. And the great thing about this movie is, like, is he a hero? Is he a bad guy? He's this man who can't form new memories, trying to solve his wife's murder. And then the very last scene is just shocking. It's like, maybe he solved the murder many times. Maybe there is no murderer. Maybe he did it. You just don't know. And it just creates this mystery. Well shot, great cast. It's also funny as hell. And it's just an amazing movie that kickstarted this century and probably kickstarted the great movies that we're all talking about.
So this is tough. I kept to you for a second, but just so I'm clear on how I'm going to be judging this, I need you each to tell me why yours is more iconic than the other two. Why is yours going to be put in the time capsule before the other two movies? Movie Mance, did you have a cleanup?
Just actually correcting, not really a cleanup, but a clarification. Memento did, in fact, come out in 2000. It premiered at the Venice Film Festival in September of 2000. It made its U.S. debut at the Sundance Film Festival in January of 2001. So either way,
oh, okay. I thought it was 99.
Yeah, I was about to say.
Dodge a bullet there.
Okay. So you're good.
So which movie is going to be put in that time capsule, the 2000s, before the other two? Go ahead. Let's hear why the other ones aren't as strong.
I mean, I was really kind of going with best. I think the best movie should be put in a time capsule because it's the best movie. I think, again, this is so hard because those two are such great movies. My criticisms of Wolf of Wall Street would be, I love the movie. I think there's a little fat in it. I think it could have been 15, 20 minutes shorter. I think it hits some double beats. I realize my movie is long as well, but I think that was all stuff that was crucial to the development of the character. Memento, again, I love that movie. I feel like it built on the foundation of some other movies like Pulp Fiction that did nonlinear storytelling. And while it is a great film, I thought it was a great early film for Christopher Nolan. It's still enjoyable, but I feel like he's gone on to do better movies. And it's hard for me to put Memento up there over, you know, these two, really.
I think that, yeah, Wolf of Wall Street is, you said yours is 2 hours long, feels like 90 minutes. I think Wolf of Wall Street is 3 hours long and feels like 90
minutes. Mine's 3 hours.
There's not a scene I would cut from Wolf of Wall Street, because you said it's full of fat, but the fat is kind of the point. It's a movie about excess that gives you excess. It pummels you with montage after montage of this gluttony, and it doesn't make a judgment call on it. It just presents it to you as, this is what's going on. It's up to you to make a decision whether you want to be complicit in this or not. Not like Wall Street or American Psycho, where there's a very heavy-handed, these are the bad guys. This is just presenting reality to you that we're all Jordan Belfort. We're all the audience at the end being handed, sell me this pen. We're all greedy, and this movie shows it to us and asks us whether we're okay with that.
My issue, and these are small issues, but my problem with Wolf of Wall Street is, we've seen movies about excess, and we've seen movies about greed and corporation. This was the best one of those, but it's not a new, it's not breaking new ground. Yours, great movie, innovative, completely falls apart in the last 20 minutes. I think it just goes off the rails and kind of loses, like, all that motivation, all that character development. It was like, yeah, he's just kind of a crazy loon.
I disagree.
I like the bowling alley. Yeah.
No,
yeah,
I'm
finished.
Go ahead, sorry.
No, it's, I know how it feels. the thing about Memento is, I don't think it was like taking off Pulp Fiction. I think it's groundbreaking cinema that no one's even barely tried to do, because it's so impressive and so hard. Mine's the only movie that pushes the boundaries of filmmaking. So you're putting that time capsule in there. You want something that like pushed the boundaries of filmmaking. And I've never seen a movie, especially a mystery, that puts you in the place of the protagonist, if he is indeed the protagonist, and like you're living his life. You feel what it's like to lose that memory.
I feel like but we're living all three of these lives in this movie.
Yeah.
There are three really iconic.
I don't know.
Characters.
Yeah,
Jordan
like
Belfort's talking to the camera. Like,
I mean, all three of these characters are iconic characters. You're fine.
I never felt, I felt like a spectator in yours. Like, you know, that was
no,
very
you're
fun.
Complicit. You're part of it.
And then
he's talking to you. Hey, you don't care what I'm talking about with IPOs and stuff like that. Let's go make some money.
And
so my problem with
just to be clear with the, I need one last final closing. Right. Are you hitting the other two? Any other facts you want
to
throw in?
Well, I'd like to address. Go ahead, I'd like Spencer, to defend. Oh, sorry.
Let Spencer.
I mean,
go
talk
first.
About Time Capsule. This is the movie that defines the last 5 years, and I know it. There Will Be Blood kind of makes the same point, but it's through metaphor. This is actually showing you as it is today. They put the real Jordan Belfort in the movie to show you that there are no consequences to this kind of behavior. And Memento, I like Memento. It's not a gimmick. It's a really smartly chopped up and reconstructed movie. You're right, Pulp Fiction did it already. But where that fails for me is that it's kind of two-dimensional. Like Memento, or like Christopher Nolan's other work, it's like a puzzle box that you have to figure out. It's like the joy of the movie is figuring out what happened, whereas I think what Dan and I picked are two three-dimensional character-driven movies, not like a intellectual challenge. That if it floats your boat, you love Christopher Nolan, but that's what Memento was for me, was like a word problem.
See, do you want to go? Or?
I think you're up next.
Okay. That's me being polite for this round.
Just really trying to win now.
No. I've been always trying to win. The problem is both your movies about greed, and they're all about, I don't think they're three-dimensional characters. I think they're two-dimensional characters, even one-dimensional characters done really well, who all they care about is money and substance and excess. That's what both those movies are. What this movie is, you're going with this protagonist, but is he the good guy? Is he the bad guy? Was he the guy who actually murdered his wife? Yeah, it's a puzzle box, but it's like a great puzzle box, not you know, where you are figuring out. You're just as invested in that movie as the characters. You're the one trying to figure it out. I've never been drawn into a movie more than Memento. And like, as trying to figure out the mystery, it like I took notes the first time I watched that movie. Like,
is that a good thing?
Yeah, yeah. No, it is. It is, because like, not every movie should have to do that. But like, when you're solving a mystery and you're compelled to it, and you're drawn in by the characters, and everyone's duplicitous, everyone has their own agenda. You see the different sides of that agenda. It turns out to it. It's just this great thriller. You know, and then you don't know who to trust, you don't know who to love, you don't know who to believe in.
Good, Dan.
I agree with Spencer that Memento is a great movie. It's a great mystery, but I think I'm going to narrow it down to our two movies, because they are similar. They tell similar stories of the downfall of a man due to, you know, materialism and greed. Where I think There Will Be Blood, if you want to go with the time capsule argument, where I think There Will Be Blood has a bit of an advantage, as you said, is that The Wolf of Wall Street does encapsulate the story of the last 5 years. I think There Will Be Blood is a much more timeless telling of the same kind of story, in that it's set in a particular era, but I think a lot of The Wolf of Wall Street and a lot of a lot of the, I think it loses, it's going to lose a little bit in the context as the context goes away and we're not in the investment banking scandal. In addition to, again, like I say, I know that it's a movie about excess, but I do think that there is, and this is, we have to get down to the nitty gritty there. There is some trimming to be done there. I think it hits you on the head, hits the point on the head a little too hard. There Will Be Blood, my closing argument for There Will Be Blood would be that human stories aren't, you know, tied to a date or time, and I think that over these two, There Will Be Blood is a little bit more of a timeless movie. I don't think it falls apart at the end. I think that he gets rid of his son, which is the last shred of his humanity, and that scene in the bowling alley is just pure id. It's just his toxic nature has taken over, and he's just become, you know, the inhuman monster that was always trying to get out. That's my interpretation, but I get that people don't like it, and I think that's what great movies should do, is not just be great movies, but challenge you, and I think that There Will Be Blood challenges you as a viewer.
But to me, it's so great when a movie can transcend being a movie and create a conversation beyond what that movie is. And There Will Be Blood,
I think all
but
three
that
of
conversation's
these did that.
Gonna go away.
I think all three of these do that. I gotta make a call because this is gonna be our longest episode ever. I'm just gonna let it go long. I apologize. I hope that's okay.
This is the champ.
I gotta make the call. You all said your final pieces. It's tough. I have a favorite of those three. I'm throwing it out the window and basing off what you said, and the winner I'm choosing is not my favorite of these three. So to be clear, I'm going off the argument, and I think Dan pulled it very closely there at the end with some really good facts, man. And I think There Will Be Blood is taking the point. What Dan gets it, and that evens us out, correct?
Evens us out. We got two and two, and I just gotta say I am surprised that neither of you guys mentioned the real best movie of the O's, which is Children of Men.
It's a great one. There's so many.
Children of Men is great.
I don't know if I would pick those over that over these three either. I don't know. Let's for sake of time, let's go to round seven.
Oh yeah.
Mick Dinglefart on Twitter asked us.
Let's bring this conversation back down to the level we're used to.
I love that name. Thank you, Mick Dinglefart.
You ruined the class.
With so many remakes being thrown at us, they're coming in every day. We could find one and make this relevant, but we all know that remakes are happening all the time. We've talked about a few even today. For the final battle here, to take you into the final round, one of you is going to win and get to the finals. The other two will have to do a tiebreaker. And we're going to try and do this quick because I don't want us to be a two-hour show just because that's too long for these shows. It's too much, guys. Don't complain at me. It's too long. So pitch us for Fight 7. Pitch us your idea for the perfect remake movie. So you're each going to give me your pitch. Please give it to me in under a minute or so or under. We're going to do a quick back and forth, and I will do closing, and I will make the decision quickly. Are we all clear? We're going to cut this one a little tighter.
Yep.
So, Spencer, you're starting. Pitch us your idea for the perfect remake.
All right. I want to remake 1994, I believe, Swingers.
Six,
yes. So no movie has captured dating and working in 1990s Los Angeles as well as Swingers has. But so much has changed since then that I think there's actually a reason to remake this movie. Favreau gets to direct this time. He was starring, Doug Liman directed last time, with SNL's Pete Davidson as the struggling actor who leaves New York City after his long-term girlfriend dumps him, and Eric Andre as the charismatic Vince Vaughn type. I just think there's a lot of universal truths to this movie about getting over a breakup, starting a date again, hanging out with your buddies, but all the details have changed since 1996. There's texting, there's Uber, social media, Tinder, internet porn, all the specifics of dating and going out and working in Los Angeles have changed, but the core of it remains the same, so I think it'd be a fun place to revisit for a remake.
Nick?
Well, I'm swinging for the fences. That's why I'm remaking Lethal Weapon. Channing Tatum playing Riggs, Will Smith playing Murtaugh, directed by the Russo brothers. And here's the thing about the buddy cop genre. Everything's been done. You've had the funny regular guy. You've had the black-white guy, white-black, guy-dog, guy-grandma, guy-Dennis Rodman. The one thing that you haven't done in original buddy cop movie is having two former lovers partnered up and teamed up with each other. And that's what we'll do. They're not just partners. They were partners. That's right. Riggs and Murtaugh dated before they were forced to team up. And now they have to deal with the last best combo for buddy cops. And, because the thing is, buddy cops bicker. How hard is it to be a partner with someone you used to date, you used to love? How are you going to dodge a bullet for someone who broke your heart?
It's Chuck and Larry meets 21 Jump Street.
No, it's a great action movie.
I just want to watch Mel Gibson and Danny Glover make out.
Yeah. No, and I'm sorry, but it's the last way to do a buddy cop movie, and you got to team it with Lethal Weapon because it's the only way that would make the impact. I thought about this. If you did with Tango and Cash, it would be a joke. You would have to take a franchise that means something to do something this powerful, this innovative, and it's, you know, it's Lethal Weapon with former lovers.
Dan.
So I chose a movie that's actually a very well-respected movie, but I think got a couple things wrong. I chose The Shining. I think 1980's The Shining is a great Stanley Kubrick movie, but it's not a great adaptation of Stephen King's material. They tried to do it for television back in the 90s. It was not good. And I think that there are enough differences in Stephen King's story that it could use a proper adaptation. I've chosen my director, Paul Thomas Anderson, who I was just talking about. He specializes in stories about men who succumb to their weaknesses, and that's what The Shining is about. It's about a man who succumbs to his weakness. For Jack Torrance, I chose Christian Bale. I think we've seen shades of the fact that he can go dark with American Psycho. For Wendy, I chose Kate Winslet. I think that she can play a really good mixture of weakness and strength. Shelley Duvall was the weakness in The Shining because Wendy is a strong character, but also who also has weaknesses of her own. And for the kid, I think that he can find an unknown. P.T. Anderson can do that. He did it in Magnolia. He did it in There Will Be Blood.
Some cleanup before we start.
The TV movie came out in 1997, and interesting that you pointed out that your favorite movie of the O's was There Will Be Blood, because Paul Thomas Anderson, that is his tribute to Stanley Kubrick.
Oh, so there you go.
So there you go.
Stephen Weber from Wings was Jack Torrance in that TV movie. It was not
so
that good.
Spencer, you were rolling your eyes at that.
Oh, man, that's brutal. Dude, The Shining is a perfect movie. It's so good. I just feel like that's sacrilege to take a Kubrick movie and remake that with like today's hot stars to cash in on The Shining.
That's
name.
Not what it is at all.
Because
that's what yours is too, a little bit.
You said it yourself that they already tried rebooting the Stephen King one, and it wasn't any good.
Because it was done on television.
With Stephen King's involvement.
Yeah, like Stephen King's, the changes from what I remember aren't particularly great. I think you're just playing with one of my favorite movies of all time, and it still holds up so much. There's no reason to remake that. There's no reason to remake The Shining. It's perfect. And then Good Cop, Gay Cop. Yeah, I mean, that sounds like fun. I don't see why it has to be Lethal Weapon. It just seems like gay buddy cop movie.
No, it has to be Lethal Weapon because otherwise no one would take it seriously. And I think it needs that brand. It needs that history, that legacy for people to take it seriously.
Why? I don't understand why that makes it more serious than just doing a
Because if you do Tango and Cat, then it becomes 21 Jump Street.
But it's not Tango and Cat. If we just made an original movie that's a gay buddy cop movie, why wouldn't someone take that seriously? Why does Lethal Weapon make it more serious?
Because it's that franchise. It's that history. It's that legacy. And I think that's what gives it. I want to do the original buddy cop drama, buddy cop action movie, and put these characters in these situations. And my idea is the only one that actually changes the game instead of just updating using characters. I mean, that are like common actors. Yours sounds exactly the same with one of the same creators, just with new people. And yours is kind of the similar thing. It's just, and then it's like the third or fourth reboot.
Yeah, yours seems exactly. It's like the Psycho remake.
It's not at all. No. First of all, your Swingers remake is coming out this summer. It's called Entourage.
No, it's second, that's really second, wow.
That is a low blow. Oh.
Secondly,
it's true. It's that true.
So, they could not it's be more
true.
Different.
It's so
they could
true.
Not be
Look
more
at those two
different.
Movies and tell me that's not the same
one.
Thing. Secondly, Nick, I think
it's not true.
I think people take your movie less seriously because it's Lethal Weapon. I think people would be way more into it if it was an original movie, and that instead of just like Riggs and Murtaugh are gay now, there's no reason to make reason to make that Lethal Weapon.
Then you think it's Chuck and Larry. Then no one would go to it, but people would go see it.
Chuck and Larry weren't actually gay. They were faking gay to get benefits.
No, but if people saw Lethal Weapon, then they're going to go like, well, it's Lethal Weapon, so I got to go, even though it might be controversial. And then maybe some minds will change. Maybe, appearances will like, fake AIDS will drop.
When Lethal Weapon 4 came out, they didn't say it's Lethal Weapon, so I got to go. It's Lethal Weapon has no currency in today's society. Anyway, I'm sorry.
It's not really a remake of Lethal Weapon. It's a completely different movie.
Yeah.
No, it's not. Yours is the same exact thing.
No,
mine is actually trying to do something different.
The only similarity is that this is a movie that tries to take a genuine look at what dating is like from a guy's perspective, and that has changed since 1996. That has changed since 1996. There's room to revisit it because everything's changed except for the core of it. So that's a reason to remake
the movie. Isn't every sitcom about that? about dating in today's modern time?
There's some good
ones. I mean,
ones.
Entourage was tough, but like...
But not ones that take a grounded, real look at it. This isn't a big movie. This is like, you do it for $2 million and you do it, you shoot it on a shoestring budget. It's an indie, and I think it'd be a really good excuse to revisit the concept of swingers. It's not ruining... a sacred cow.
Well, think mine could be its own movie. Yours could be its own movie. It doesn't need to be swingers.
Mine
needs the title to bring people in.
Well, let me just say that I think that, as I said, and you just said, I think both of your movies could be an original concept. It doesn't have to be tied to the original. The reason that I want to recommend, it's not a cheap remake, and believe me, I have nothing but respect for the Kubrick film. But what I'm saying is that Stephen King's source material is equally intriguing, and the real heart of that story is the gradual decline of the character of Jack Torrance. It's much less ambiguous in the novel what exactly is going on. It's much more about
Please let me finish.
It's much less about his personal demons. And in the Shining Kubrick movie, Jack Nicholson is a dad, and then he's crazy. You don't see that. You don't see that decline. So what I'm saying is, I think you can remake The Shining in the hands of a capable director, take that material, adapt it properly. It's not Carrie. It's not a cheap reboot. It's imagining the story through the lens of Stephen King with the proper resources done correctly. No disrespect to Kubrick. I think it's a great companion piece.
I think it'd be fun.
It's not a disrespect to Kubrick. They're two different movies. Kubrick made a very technical, great movie. This would be a much more in-depth character about the stories, and I think it's one of Stephen King's best stories, and it deserves to be adapted.
And
I
Stephen
think
it King is had his chance. He was like the executive producer. He cast the guy from Wings.
Yeah, but exactly. It was a TV movie with the guy from Wings.
That was his decision. It was like remaking
The Godfather based on the novel. We don't need to do it.
The Godfather novel's not good. That's what I'm saying.
I'm just going to flat out say it. The movie, Kubrick's movie, is better than the book.
I disagree. The novel, The Shining, is a great story about a family, and that story was not properly adapted in Kubrick's version. As great as it is, I'm telling you that it's a great story, and it can be told in a way that's not just a cheap knockoff remake, that it's a great story about a man, his weaknesses, the decline of his family.
Okay, and then why? So, closing arguments. You've each defended yours well, but I need to just understand quickly, 1 minute each, quick or less, if possible. Why not the other two? Go ahead.
Why
Dan.
Not the other? Two?
Swingers again. Like I said, I think there's lots of movies about dating in the modern world. There's TV shows about it. I don't think you need to attach the swingers name. I mean, 15 indie movies come out a month about this is dating in the modern world, and they're all low budget indies. I don't think you need to attach the swingers name to it. That is a movie very much of its time, and I don't think that you need to take it out of its time and update it when that subject matter is being covered in other mediums. I think with your movie, calling it Lethal Weapon hurts it because it's so different from the original Lethal Weapon that it's just not necessary. People will go see original movies if they're good. And I think that adding that extra wrinkle to the Lethal Weapon is just not necessary, especially it doesn't have to be called Lethal Weapon. It can just be a gay buddy cop movie, which you're right, we haven't seen, but making it Lethal Weapon just, it hurts it. It doesn't
Nick,
help it.
Take the other two out, please, quickly.
Yes. We've seen that movie. We've seen it 100 times. We don't need to see that movie. And I'm sorry, your movie has happened. Stephen King had his chance. I don't need to see a third, Shining remake. It's already happened. I mean, choose another book. Strip Mine more of his material, I guess. But like, I just feel like it's something different. And again, I'd rather see Paul Thomas Anderson's The Movie You Just Went Around For do his like spiritual successor to that than redo another Shining.
It's Spencer, just, thoughts?
To me, the point of a remake is to take the core of the source material and add a new spin on it. Otherwise, there's no reason to do it. And for yours, I think there's nothing new enough just by adding some deleted scenes from Stephen King's book. Yours, just adding a gayness to Lethal Weapon is not enough reason to update it. Whereas with mine, the entire world of dating and working and living in Los Angeles has changed since 1996. It'd be fun to revisit that in 2015-16.
I have 100 web series you can watch.
Man, this is really hard. Man, I gotta give it based on the arguments we're doing here, right? Based on the arguments here, I think one competitor knocked the other two down the hardest, and for that entourage jab alone,
Dan Murrow's the same. That's
well,
offensive.
I don't really want to see that movie.
That's offensive.
To be fair, but I respect the argument, and you. Dan takes it to the end.
Thank
what?
You.
Wow.
Wow.
Wow. That was the Entourage job was a solid one.
Yeah, it's a job.
But we were making fun of him about how dumb
I also think he knocked you both down. We've all seen right. it before, all and right. I don't understand what... Lethal Weapon does not help that movie.
Yes, it does.
The people who want to go see Lethal Weapon do not want to go see...
They won't see
Gay
it
Cops.
They won't
sadly,
see it.
We should try and get them to be a better...
And they need that draw to bring it in.
All right, so that means, Scott, help me out here. That means, Dan, you are in the finals. And that means we have two people fighting for the last spot. So it's still anyone's game. 3 points for Dan, 2 and 2. You don't earn a point, though. You just get your place. All right? Before...
One question?
Yes.
Okay.
But before we do that tiebreaker round, I would like to do a quick round to our sponsor, Loot Crate.
Good.
Thank you guys for. I know this seems annoying. There's so much tension here, but it's important that we talk about our friends at Loot Crate because without them, we can't do the show. We need sponsors to do the show, and we actually really love Loot Crate. We're all members of Loot Crate, so please go and support them. Go to lootcrate.com/moviefights and use the code moviefights to sign up for a new subscription and save 10%. If you sign up before April 19th, you'll get the Fantasy Crate with items from Game of Thrones, Princess Bride, and so much more stuff. So again, please go support our friends at Loot Crate. Go get that 10%. Put in your code MovieFights at lootcrate.com/moviefights. Link is in the description below. Thank you, Loot Crate. I hope you all are getting them and supporting us and them. Now, back to this.
New wrinkle two bonus round.
So the way this works, thank you for explaining. For bonus round and for tiebreakers, we've changed the rules slightly. So let me clarify for everyone who's watching. This is important. Because this is an important game-changing round, it's not who said it first gets to win. If you say it first, that's the pick you're picking. The other person has to quickly announce theirs, and you will both say your piece. We don't want it to be disqualification to count
in
this round.
We can talk the fastest, yeah.
And also for this round, this won't happen this because I don't want the champion to deter it, but when we move forward to the speed round, there will be one more addition. I will determine the winner of this, and then we will explain how it will work during the speed round. All right, are you guys ready?
Ready.
Tie-breaking question. I'm adding one from our first round. Here we go. Who is the worst? I'm going to give you a choice of two.
Okay.
Okay? Before you both say it. Who is the worst Batman? George Clooney or Val Kilmer?
George Clooney.
Val Kilmer.
Okay, Spencer, why George Clooney?
He only got half the role. He plays a good Bruce Wayne, but not Batman. That's half the role. If you can't play a convincing Batman, you can't even rotate your neck. Then who cares about the rest of your performance? He was also trapped in a much worse movie than Batman Forever.
Why Val Kilmer?
Val Kilmer had no charisma in that movie. He had no heart. He didn't want to be there. It was just lazy. He just kind of like regurgitated things, and they had a stuntman literally do all the fighting. You can't actually see like a close-up shot of him like throwing and punching. He was just lazy. He didn't want to do it. He almost got fired halfway through. He was just boring as hell. Clooney at least
heard it. Because it's important, I'm giving you each one last final point. Go.
I think that I'd rather have a stoic and cold Batman than one that, like you said, needs a stuntman to replace him. That was a good choice because instead you got George Clooney trying to fight in a bat suit.
I just don't think Val Kilmer wanted to care, and Clooney at least has some charisma. It's not his fault he was in the worst movie ever made.
But I think there is a point made, both of you, that I think
he's half man, not Batman.
Spencer wanted to say he wasn't a good Batman.
Yeah.
I mean, whether about Spencer or not, he played the brain. It just that was right. That's the winner. Spencer gets it to the end. I'm sorry, Nick. That was close. Now, Nick, you're going to join me here for this final round. And
you're
the way this
screwed.
Is going to work, the way this is going to work is I have 5 questions for this speed round, and you and our fact checker, Movie Mance, are going to help vote on who made the best argument, because I don't want this to be resting on my shoulders, even though I'm allowed to do that. I want this, since this is the championship and this belt that I'm about to lift up is on the line, you both will each take a vote. I will be the deciding vote, and we will determine who wins each round of this. Is that clear to everybody?
Yes.
The Woo-hoo! Sword of Damocles is drawing near.
Okay, so.
I just wanted to make sure I didn't go out before this. I'm okay from here on out. Let's
We're all winners, guys. You get to see Age of Ultron. You're a winner.
All right, so to be clear, this is on the line, everybody. I'm gonna wear it proudly in the meanwhile. It's the only time I get to do this. Woo-hoo, wow.
Very
and
good.
And it's also just a place to hold it.
No one can see
okay.
it.
Okay. Everyone understand how the speed round, this new one, will work.
Yes.
If you both say the same answer at the same time, that's okay. Quickly say your next or say the other version.
So you have to say the other. You have to fight for the other one.
Yes.
Basically.
If you both said the same answer, the other person has to fight for the other one if I heard
gotcha.
Joe on the first.
Deal. Gotcha.
Everyone make sense?
Yes. Ready.
And the winner will be determined by, I will ask Nick, Mance their opinions, and I will be the deciding factor.
And he's one up on me, right?
Yes, he's one up on you, right. Spencer, so you have to get these. All right. Now, for the championship belt on the line, let's begin the speed round.
Spencer won.
Nothing. See, that's what I tell you.
I'm kidding.
No, Nick.
I'm kidding. I swear.
I'm going to take you away.
No, I'm playing.
If you don't play this fairly.
I'm playing.
This is not a thing is on my mic. Sorry. All right. Play fairly. You want the best winner to win, yes?
Of course I do.
You're not having some dated feelings.
No.
Okay.
With those answers?
I believe you. All right. Number one. At Travis of Marvel. Big fan of ours. Mm-hmm. We love you, Travis.
Yeah, Travis is fine.
He asks, both of these films are on cable. Which do I watch? Mortal Kombat or Street Fighter?
Mortal Kombat.
Mortal Kombat. Well, I was saying it, but I was waiting for you to finish.
Dan gets Mortal Kombat.
No, I was saying
Yeah, but you didn't say the name.
Oh, that's
so brutal. You have to pick Street Fighter.
Yeah, fine.
Okay. You sound disappointed. Don't show that so quickly.
And it's best argument, right? I've never
done
this.
Yes, best argument. So I'm going to each Nick and Movie Mance, listen to these arguments quickly. We will each get one shot. Go ahead. Why Mortal Kombat?
Mortal Kombat is much closer to being an actually good movie. The fight scenes are pretty good. And, you know, it kind of gets cast aside as just another comic book movie, but it's not that bad. Street Fighter, man. It's just Raul Julia flying around on wires for a couple hours. None of the characters match who they should be. The portrayals are all off. Mortal Kombat, I think, is actually not a bad movie. Street Fighter is awful.
They're both bad movies.
Why Street Fighter, yes.
But I have this to say about Street Fighter. Yes, you do have Raul Julia floating around on wires, but he does have one of the most badass quotes in all of film. It is to Chung Li, and it's something along the lines of, "The day I burned down your village and murdered your family was the worst day of your life. To me, it was Tuesday." And that is the most badass villain
line.
But
does it have the Mortal Kombat song? Because my movie's got the Mortal Kombat song.
Yeah. You get one last thought since you throw that in. Quickly.
Street Fighter 2 has Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Okay.
No!
Movie Mance, who's your vote there?
I'm Dan, going with Mortal Kombat. Mortal Kombat felt like a
But
precursor.
You got to go off his argument.
Okay, yes. Going off his argument, I'm down with Mortal Kombat. It was ahead of its time.
Okay. But make sure you're listening to his argument. He didn't say that.
I said it was a better movie.
Better fights, you did say, okay.
Yeah.
But make sure you were listening to the arguments. Nick, based on those arguments, who did you pick?
Look, Spencer was winning. I'm going with Dan for the Mortal Kombat song.
Yeah. Right.
Why?
The Mortal Kombat song. Like, he pulled that out. Like, that will stand the test of time more than anything else in that.
I don't disagree. Okay. I think that was a fair vote, and I think Mortal Kombat is the better movie if we're all being objective. And even you admitted it because you were annoyed.
Except that Raul Julia. Street Fighter killed
Raul Julia.
All
right, Dan has the point. It's 4-2. So Spencer, you got to get one. Get on the board.
Yeah.
Jackson Latner asked, worst movie starring Robert Downey Jr.?
The Judge.
Worst movie?
5 seconds, Dan.
Iron Man 2. I can change my answer.
Wait.
He hasn't answered yet.
Iron Man 2, yeah. Wait, what? I was about to say Iron Man 2, and then he shouted out Iron Man 2.
Wow, why did you do that?
No, I didn't say anything yet.
He said that you said
that. Why would you do that?
He said the Judge.
My bad.
So you're going to take his answer?
No, I'm going to take Iron Man 2.
Okay, that's what I'm saying. You're taking what he spit out to you.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I was literally about to say
Iron
Man 2.
That's fine, I'm sorry I did that.
Spencer, I don't know why I did that. You're wrecking the rules here. Okay, The Judge versus Iron Man 2. Go ahead, Spencer.
I just think The Judge is the last thing we want to see Robert Downey Jr. doing, which is a father-son legal drama relationship. Whereas Iron Man 2, he's in the Iron Man suit. At least he's giving you that.
I mean, the last thing you want to see Robert Downey Jr. do is act. I don't get it. I mean, he was just acting. It was a role. I think Iron Man 2, the expectations after the first Iron Man were so sky high. And by the time we got to Iron Man 2, it was just a disappointment. It had a weak villain, and he just crushed it so well in the first one. Iron Man was kind of sidelined. You're with Mickey Rourke and Sam Rockwell. It just didn't do it for me.
Nick, based on the arguments.
They don't get a rebuttal?
No, I'm not going to give him one this time. Movie Mance.
Man, no, the Judge is so shitty, but like...
based on the arguments.
Yeah, Dan gave the better argument on that one.
I'm with Dan.
Dan gets the point again. I felt the same way, and I think you sort of threw yourself there under the bus. That was pretty stupid of you, Spencer. I think you need to win. No, is it
over? No, it's over.
No, one, two, three. It's not over. You need to win the next three.
Whoa, okay.
If you win the next three, you win, and we go to a final tiebreaker.
Should put
it's happened before on the show.
Oh, yeah.
Spencer, once you say your choice, you have to stick to it. This is a very fun show to watch. Very tense.
This is very exciting. We'll have a Harry Potter threesome after this.
Future Mr. Sutton asks, best Hollywood William?
Shatner.
5 seconds.
H. Macy.
Shatner versus H. Macy. Go ahead, Dan.
Listen, William H. Macy is a great character actor. He's been a great supporting role in a lot of movies. William Shatner is Captain Kirk. He's Star Trek II, all of those amazing Star Trek movies. He's the captain of the Starship Enterprise. He beat Khan. William H. Macy, great supporting actor, great character actor. He is not an icon like William Shatner.
Spencer.
I think you said Captain Kirk like 3 or 4 times in your answer, whereas William H. Macy is a chameleon. He disappears into his roles. He's a great character actor with more flexibility and range. Shatner's Shatner.
Nick, you're going with Spencer. Wow. Movie man, who are you going with?
Going with Dan. William Shatner, Captain Kirk, icon.
That doesn't make him good.
William Shatner, Captain Kirk,
icon. It's coming
icon.
Back to me. I'm going to give you one last deciding vote. It's going to be on my shoulders to decide. One last closing argument. Dan?
I mean, again, if you're talking about best Hollywood William, these iconic characters, these iconic faces, I'm using the I word, and I apologize, but that's what William Shatner is. He's an icon. I love William H. Macy. He's a great, actor, but I think if you're talking best, it's somebody who's created the most memorable character. He is a chameleon in that you don't really remember any of the roles that he plays.
You said yourself, he's a great actor, whereas Captain Kirk, a.k.a. William Shatner, has turned into a parody of himself as his career has gone on, where William H. Macy's still going strong.
I need you to name one acting role, and you didn't do it, Spencer, because he just called you out, and you didn't do it. And
what?
So, sadly, for that reason, I've got to give the bell back to Dan Murrow. You were so close. If you had said Fargo, if you had said anything,
did
I would
have. Did he ask me? I wasn't.
Yeah,
I
he said, you can't
Look at your
verdict.
Wow,
look at this.
Wow.
This is a cheesy.
Way to go, Dan.
Dan Murrow, I am so honored to hand it back. I can't believe you're undefeated again.
Undefeated, Dan.
This is unreal.
This was the hardest
this
it's
was
ever
unreal.
Been. Oh my God,
Dan, guys! Dan, wow, thank you. That was amazing.
See you in 3 months, Dan.
Oh. Amazing. Yeah. All right. So to clarify here, that belt's going to be put away for a little while, just so everyone understands. And we want you to fight. No stress with that belt. We're going to do another one of these very long title bouts later on. But in the meanwhile, we're just going to have some fun. We have some awesome, awesome belts and fights coming up. I'm going to tell you, actually, we have one you've been asking for forever. CinemaSins is finally coming on to take us on in May. So we have so many fun guests. Chris Stuckman's coming on. We have so many fun people that we're booking to do some really fun, exciting new guests that you've been asking for. Keep telling us who you want to see on this show because we need to see that in the comments on Twitter. And thanks so much for telling us for keeping that online. Yes, Movie Mance, we're gonna have you back. Jesus,
yes, relax.
Desperate.
I would like to thank Andy on this round, especially. This wasn't easy for you. Mm. This gave me PTSD from just choosing this.
It was very hard. I think we're already at almost 2 hours. So let me wrap this up quickly so I can get us out of here. Dan, congratulations. As always, please tell us what you would like to see in the comments below or tweet at us which fights you want to see. And please tell us who you want us to bring on to the show because we are going to bring on some awesome new people. And Dan, the belt is going to be off your head for a bit. We'll bring it back to fight, but let's see you fight some just random fights, some street fights.
Yeah.
Also, please go check us out on iTunes. New feed, description in the link. Link is in the description below. Please go subscribe to the new feed.
People
still ask us. I don't know why. There's a new feed. Go to the new feed. You'll see the more current episodes there. Please go support us. I want to thank each of our guests. Wow, Spenny, you almost brought it up. You flubbed it, though, that Iron Man 2 moment.
Yeah, speed round, my Achilles heel still.
At Spencer J. Gilbert, wow. I hope you'll keep coming back.
Big thanks to the fans who are still listening. I mean, geez, 2 hours?
Hashtag still watching.
Yeah.
Hit us up and tell us that you're still watching. Nick Mundy at Dick Fundy.
Thank you guys for having me. This was fun. Also, this Monday, tomorrow, watch Nothing to Report on ComedyCentral.com.
Oh, please go support that with Chris Jericho, right?
Please watch
Nick Mundy and Chris Jericho. We'll be tweeting out and supporting it.
Yeah.
This Monday on ComedyCentral.com.
This Monday.
Okay, great.
Tomorrow.
We'll make sure we tweet it out, so pay attention, follow us.
Thank you very much.
And then at Merle Dan, the champion, is still Don't call him shouty, or don't call him pouty, because he'll get shouty.
I apologize. I think I got a little shouty, and I love Nick. People say that I hate Nick because we get into it. This guy is awesome, and
we all love each other.
And I love everybody here. So
on the fact checking, thank you for bringing up your crazy IMDb head. It's at Movie Mance, Scott Mance. Thank you. Did you have fun?
I had the best time.
Was that a crazy fight?
That was brilliant. I'll tell you, I just wanted to jump in, but you guys were off and running. Dan, I hope I made you proud by being the fact
you
checker
did great.
Today.
He was good.
Thank you so much. And please, I just want to say, please check out Profiles.
Yes.
Go to our Facebook page. It's Profiles with Malone and Mance. Next week, we're doing Russell Crowe. We're talking to Russell Crowe.
Wow. Please was he a jerk?
I'll let you know tomorrow.
It seems like he'd be a nice guy, I hope. And then please follow me on Twitter and Instagram at Andy Signor. Woo! Tell us what you want to see. Please keep telling us who you want to bring on the fight and what fights you want to see. And I want to thank again to Loot Crate. Don't forget that discount code, Loot Crate Movie Fights. Lootcrate.com/moviefights. Link in the description below. Thank you so much. We will see you next week. Woo!
Every podcast we put on YouTube comes with this kick-ass graphic listing all the topics your favorite Screen Junkies podcasters are talking about. If you click the topics, you can skip around and choose your own podcast battle royale. Go ahead, try them all. If you haven't already, subscribe to Screen Junkies on YouTube to join us for future fights. Or if you prefer to listen on iTunes, click the logo to download an audio version.